Hello, everybody. I have here with me my partner, Matt Mazur, also at Dechert. And the two of us are actually in the Securities Enforcement and White Collar Defense Group here at Dechert. But we do a lot of sort of compliance training and advising to hedge funds in addition to helping people respond to subpoenas and investigations. And today we are going to present to you sort of a basic presentation on insider trading. We've actually designed this presentation to be the sort of thing that you all as legal and compliance professionals at hedge funds, which I am guessing most of you are, can use to train your people. I'm guessing that many of you are fairly up to speed on the insider trading laws, and what we're really doing here today is trying to give you tools and equipment that you can use to interact with your folks. This presentation is actually similar to a presentation that we give directly to portfolio managers, analysts, et cetera, at hedge funds, and it's sort of to help you do that directly if you choose to. So I'm going to go over the agenda, and then I'm going to have Matt start the presentation about sort of the overview of U.S. insider trading law. So the first thing we're going to do is kind of do a sort of a basic overview of what the rules are, what the U.S. insider trading law rules are. And you'll see the last point at the very end, we'll touch briefly on sort of UK and European Union rules and how they differ from the U.S. rules. And then in the middle, we're going to have a portion that attempts to sort of address the particular situations that hedge funds often encounter, things like interactions with company management, interactions with other buy-side personnel, idea dinners, other folks at other hedge funds, interactions with sell-side analysts at sell-side banks, use of expert networks, and we're going to try to give some guidance on what the rules should be about electronic communications, emails, IMs, texts, et cetera, at your funds. So with that, I'm going to introduce Matt to start the overview of the U.S. law.
Thanks, John. So I'm guessing that most of you probably have a basic understanding and know that insider trading laws prohibit both trading on inside information and also tipping another person so that that person can trade. Our focus today, given who we understand our audience is going to be less on company insiders who improperly disclose inside information or tip, and more on of a focus on tippees and the liability that people who may be the recipients of information may be exposed to. From the perspective of the tippee, insider trading requires a number of elements. It requires trading, an actual transaction. It requires that the trading be on the basis of information that is obtained from an insider in breach of a duty to keep the information secret. The information has to be material. The information has to be non-public. The information has to be from an insider who received a personal benefit by tipping, and the trader had to knowingly have the information when the trade was made, and the tippee or trader had to have had bad or at least reckless intent or knowledge, meaning that they knew the information was obtained from an insider in breach of a duty, or had reason to know that the information was obtained from an insider in breach of a duty. And the point of going through these elements is that all of these things, breach of a duty, material, non-public, personal benefit, knowingly, reckless intent or knowledge, these are all nuanced and complicated legal concepts. And the main message to traders should really be, don't try to figure out this whole complicated definition on your own and whether it falls in there. Go to your compliance department. So we're going to go now in a little bit more detail on the key elements of insider trading. One of the first ones that I mentioned was that the information obtained from an insider has to be information that was obtained from an insider who breached a duty by disclosing the information. So think of who the traditional insiders at a company are: officers, directors, employees, people who have a duty to keep company information confidential. There can also be what are known as temporary insiders, people who may be lawyers or accountants who know confidential information about the company as a result of their professional relationships. They also have a duty to keep confidential information secret. And then there are other people who become insiders because they're bound by a duty, usually because of a written or unwritten understanding that they won't disclose information. Sometimes a company employee, a consultant, or another third party will sign a non-disclosure agreement. Sometimes it's just a matter of a course of dealing between the company and a third party that can make the third party an insider. And it can even extend to a family member or a friend. And an example of that is if the father has a daughter who works at a law firm who's working on a transaction for a company, and the daughter's staying over at the father's house for the weekend and working on the deal. If the father peruses documents that were left by the daughter on the kitchen table and learns inside information about a company, the father, although he has no relationship whatsoever with the company, can actually become an insider for purposes of insider trading, such that if he trades or he tips somebody else on the basis of information that he learns that way, there can be a breach of a duty by an insider. Next concept that we want to cover is materiality. The legal definition of what constitutes material inside information is material if it would be substantially likely to influence the decision of a reasonable investor if that investor had knowledge of the information. Now, of course, different investors might be influenced by different things, but the definition here focuses on the reasonable investor, meaning that it's supposed to be an objective test of what an investor, what would be substantially likely to influence that investor's decision. Example, obviously any significant event in the life of a company that when revealed could affect investor perceptions about the company. Common significant events include changes in management, M&A plans, tender offers, public offers of securities, upcoming research or financial reports, changes in a company's debt rating, liquidity problems, litigation, investigations, earnings estimates, dividend payments, major new discoveries or problems with technology or products, any subject that would normally fall within an 8K. There could be other information, however, including information about a significant order that may be coming to a company, an order to purchase or sell securities by a large investor, or including a hedge fund or a big financial institution. There may also be other kinds of information that is material, including what we've listed here, pre-publication information regarding reports to be published in the financial press or by sell-side research analysts.
This is John. One sort of point I want to interject here is, you know, we usually think of insider trading as an insider at a publicly traded company disclosing information about that company. But it's really broader than that. It can also be, for instance, someone inside one of your hedge funds, their plans to make a huge purchase of stock next week could actually be material non-public information, because when you do that, you're going to drive the price of those securities up by virtue of the size of your purchase. And so that information that someone inside your hedge fund knows about your fund's plans next week to make a particular purchase of securities can actually be inside information for you, the hedge fund, and that analyst who knows that is almost certainly bound by a confidentiality agreement that analyst signed with you, the hedge fund, not to disclose your trading plans in the future. And so, you know, it doesn't just need to come from a public company, it can come also from a private entity or a hedge fund or something else disclosing something that might have a market-moving effect. The other thing we mentioned here is the sell-side analyst, and you'll see in the slide about this later, you know, a sell-side analyst works at a sell-side bank and is about to change a buy or sell rating on a company he or she covers and discloses that to someone before that change has happened. They've just breached a duty to their employer, the sell-side bank, not to the company they're covering, but to the bank, and that can also be the breach of a duty and the disclosure of inside information, namely the plans to change that report. And so just to be clear, it's not just information coming from public companies. Anyway, I'll let Matt.
And some of the information that we listed that would come from public companies, like, for example, the change in a debt rating could also come from the credit rating agency. It could have the same type of information that would arrive from different sources. The bottom line, really, for traders to think about is, you know, what information would they care about when making a decision to transact in the security? And another really important thing to keep in mind is that it should a trader or a firm be the subject of an enforcement action by the authorities, they are going to view everything in hindsight. So if some piece of information, when it became public, made the price of the stock move, you can be sure that regardless of what somebody thought about the information before it became public, if it moved the stock price and in hindsight, it's clear that it was material. The SEC and the DOJ will certainly take the position that it was material.
Yeah, I mean, the advice that I generally give to hedge fund clients is if your trader or your analyst or your portfolio manager cares about the information enough to bother to go gather it and spend money to get it or spend time and effort to put it into the model, it's likely that the SEC is going to be able to use that fact that your PM or your analyst is a reasonable investor. They considered it important enough to spend money on it or time on it, then it's material. And so really this definition has become so granular that it's generally not helpful to kind of use materiality as a way to decide you're okay. And we usually like to rely on some of the other elements that Matt is covering.
The next element that I'm going to discuss is the difference between what is public as opposed to non-public information. So the information we in the definition, it has to be non-public. So information that is public is information that is generally and broadly available. So the most clear example is when the company makes a formal press release, earnings announcement, or SEC filing. But there are some less clear situations where it may seem like everybody already has access to the information. There may be rumors. There may actually be reports in the media that can make something public. But you have to be careful in those situations because if you have information from an insider that was obtained in breach of a duty and that same information is in a press report or has been rumored, the authorities are going to take the position that it is an improper advantage to have the sure thing information from the insider confirming it versus rumors or a mere press report. So something may seem like it's public but may still be viewed as non-public if it was obtained from an inside source in breach of a duty. Also, as we said before, with materiality, if the price of the stock moves after a formal public announcement by the company, the Department of Justice and the SEC will certainly argue that that shows that the information was both material and also non-public because it moved the price of the stock.
So I now want to move on to the next element, which is really sort of a sub-element of the breach of a duty. And many of you may know there's been a lot of case law recently and even a case that went to the Supreme Court on this issue of the benefit to the tipper and also a case that was decided recently or a couple of years ago now in the Second Circuit called Newman, which sort of caused a big stir in the insider trading space. And the bottom line is, in many ways, we're kind of almost back where we started when all of this litigation began, which is, the government still does need to prove that the original tipper, the original source of the information, the person at the public company who had the information about earnings, or the person inside the hedge fund who had the information about a buy plan, or the person at the sell side bank who had the information about the change in a rating or something like that, has to receive some sort of benefit from the original PIP. And that law is, you know, now kind of confirmed by the Supreme Court. But we're also back to a world in which the benefit that the tipper needs to get is a pretty limited one. The law that existed before still stands, that the giver of the information, the tipper, if they're friends with the person they're giving the information to, or their family member, or a professional associate with the person they're giving the information to, the law says that the personal satisfaction, the way in which it warms the heart of the giver, is benefit enough, and they don't need to get any money, they don't need to get anything of sort of tangible value, that the personal satisfaction they get by giving the gift of information to a friend or family member or to a professional associate is enough. And so the bottom line is the government's going to be able to prove a benefit to the tipper if the tipper and the original tippee are anything more than strangers. If they have some professional relationship, personal relationship, they're going to be able to use this, you know, gift of information theory to prove a benefit to the tipper. The other thing is that, you know, even the slightest of a professional relationship, like the possibility that someone's going to refer you business later or give you, you know, a networking, you know, advantage later, can be enough to be a benefit to the tipper and a motivation to the tipper to give over inside information. The government has even brought cases where taking someone out to dinner as a thank you for inside information, or In fact, sending someone a box of lobsters from Maine was adequate to be a benefit to the tipper. And so this is a very limited benefit that needs to come to the tipper, and the government is going to have an easy time proving it. The thing that the Newman decision said that still remains good law, even after the recent Supreme Court decision, is that the downstream tippees, the person who is three, four, five steps removed from the original tipper, needs to have some knowledge of that benefit. And so this is a real limitation on the government, that it's harder for the government to bring cases against those who are quite remote from the original tipper, because those who are quite remote from the original tipper, it's going to be very hard for the government to show that those people had any knowledge of the friendship that might have existed between the original tipper and the tippee, or whatever professional relationship existed. But as I said, the Supreme Court recently affirmed in the Salmon case that giving the gift of information to a friend or relative is enough of a benefit. The next element that I want to cover is that, you know, the law says that the trading needs to be on the basis of the inside information, and you would ordinarily think that that means that the inside information needs to have played an actual role in the trading decision, and that the insider needs to have, or the tippee needs to have actually kind of considered and used that information in his or her trading decision. But it's not so. The Second Circuit has decided that if a person possesses inside information, we are going to presume that they used it in their trading decision. And the theory behind this is that, you know, one can't divide their brain and put information barriers in their brain. And once information is inside someone's brain, it's very hard for them not to consider it in a trading decision. Now, where this gets complicated for those of you on the phone, you know, who work at hedge funds, is you work inside an organization, and it's not necessarily true that the information inside one person's brain is also inside the brains of everybody else at the organization. But the law presumes that unless you have erected information barriers between the person who has the inside information and those who are making the trading decisions, and ones that are going to pass muster with the SEC, like electronic separation, possibly physical separation, you know, training of all the players, documentation, et cetera, the law is going to presume that once any person inside your firm has a piece of inside information, everybody has got it. And this is why when someone comes into possession of inside information, they should sort of do one of two things. they should go straight to compliance, and possibly an information barrier can be put up around the person at that time, or possibly the compliance department and the legal department are going to have to restrict the whole institution's trading in that security, even though only one person knows it. And that's sort of, you know, how the law treats causation. It basically presumes that you use the information unless there's an information barrier to show that those making the trading decisions could not and did not have the information.
So the next element is the element of intent, bad intent, or knowledge. Now, for an insider or a tipper to be liable, that person must know or have reason to know that the tippee, the person receiving the information, was likely to trade on the information. As I said, our focus today is really more on the tippees, and for a tippee to be liable, the tippee must know or have reason to know that the insider violated a duty by providing the information. There are different levels of intent that are required to show civil liability versus criminal liability. So in a criminal case where a person could go to jail, you have to either have actual knowledge that the insider violated a duty by providing the information or consciously avoid that knowledge. In a civil case, such as one brought by the SEC, it's enough if the tippee was reckless, meaning that he or she knew or should have known that the insider violated a duty by providing the information, but traded or re-tipped in some cases anyway. The message really here is, you know, if it truly is an innocent mistake, it's not insider trading. But if a person makes an innocent mistake and then starts taking steps to cover up what looked like potentially insider trading, that's just going to make the firm and the person look more guilty. And really, from the perspective of a compliance officer, the question really should be, how would this look in hindsight? If you see red flags, such as information that seems like it would come from an insider, if the source of the information provides the information in a way that was secret, there is a special relationship with the source of the information, the SEC is going to say you should have known that it was inside information. So it really has to be a question of how is this going to look later. Again, any time there's a question on one of these issues, these concepts are complicated, go to compliance. And it's not just to get an answer from compliance as to whether you can trade or not. The fact that a person goes to compliance is evidence that they had good intent to follow the law.
So now we want to move to sort of away from the kind of what the rules are and spend, you know, 15, 20 minutes or so talking about sort of practical situations that come up at hedge funds typically. And one of those situations is your analysts, your portfolio managers are talking to management at companies, at publicly traded companies that they cover. And they're having one-on-ones with them at investor conferences. They're having two-on-ones with them at investor conferences. They are maybe even speaking to them on the telephone in one-on-ones or even in more sort of, you know, informal settings. And all of this is fine, and the Supreme Court has said that it is perfectly fine for investors to, you know, interact with company management to try to, you know, get, you know, better clarity about what kind of investments they might want to make. But there are risks here, and the government can be suspicious of interactions between hedge fund, you know, portfolio managers and company insiders, especially one-on-one interactions. And so I basically have some, you know, some ideas here about how to think about this that are safer. And the first of which is it's always safer to interact with, you know, investor relations or with people who investor relations have put, you know, investor relations at the company, people who investor relations have contacted your people and connected them with a kind of authorized connection like that that's organized by the investor relations department is always going to, you know, suggest that this is a permissible interaction and there's no breach of a duty going on. Similarly, C-level executives, people whose job it is to speak to the street, are trained in how to differentiate between what's what they're allowed to talk about and what they're not allowed to talk about. It's always safer to have those kind of company interactions at organized events, at those investor conferences, at events set up by the IR department, at phone calls organized and scheduled by the IR department. Those are always going to be better indicators that the disclosures that are going on are authorized. And also, if we, you know, are in an enforcement context and your intent is being evaluated, we're going to have much better arguments. Hey, how could I possibly have known there was a breach of a duty? I'm sitting there at an organized conference with investor relations in the room talking to a C-level executive. I had no reason to know that they were breaching a duty. And even if they did breach a duty, you're going to be fine because you've got no intent or no scienter. A couple of things to think about, you know, information that's kind of slipped to you on the side as you walk out of that meeting, you know, or by someone who you have a special relationship. You know, the CEO of the company is also your former college roommate, and you've got an additional kind of personal relationship with them. That's something to raise red flags and to be concerned about, that the SEC is going to think, well, this person's getting more information than the average, you know, buy-sider who's got a one-on-one with them. The other thing I have here is that you can't just rely on the company's Reg FD obligations. Companies have an obligation to make simultaneous disclosure to, you know, the broad investing public of material information, and, you know, that's a fact. But the reality is that the SEC is going to hold hedge fund managers to a high standard, too. And if something comes out in one of these interactions that was obviously material and non-public, you know, you're not just going to be able to say, well, I was assuming that they, you know, they were refereeing their Reg FD obligations. In fact, if it's obvious, you know, the SEC is also going to hold you accountable for that, basically receiving that information from a breach. Generally, you know, you can get color, confirmation, or clarification on past public statements from an issuer. You know, just a guidepost. I don't think it's a good idea to present to an insider, hey, here's what my model says, you know, the EPS is going to be on your earnings call next week, you know, and try to get them to confirm that. You're asking for sort of too much information at that time. And it's always a good idea, and we'll get to this a little bit later, for your folks to kind of make a record of their interactions with company insiders and take, you know, reasonably good notes so that, you know, 4 years later when the SEC asks questions about it, there's a record of what was said. And those notes are hopefully going to be, you know, proof of good intent. The next slide that I have is about buy-side interactions. And this is that scenario where one person at, you know, one hedge fund, you know, potentially tips a person at another hedge fund about his or her employer's plans. And if it's a big enough fund and it's a thinly enough traded stock, you know, a big purchase can move the price, and telling your friend at another hedge fund, hey, we're about to do this, why don't you front run on it, is a breach of a duty by the person providing the information, and it could be material and non-public information if it's going to move the price of that stock. And so, you know, while it's perfectly permissible for investors to share ideas across different, you know, hedge funds, you have to be careful about people breaching their duties to their employers in doing so. A couple of guideposts here. First of all, it's never okay to tip about, you know, just good old-fashioned inside information, not necessarily, you know, coming from the hedge fund, but coming from the company. And so, you know, the government is skeptical about idea dinners because they think that they're fertile ground for hedge fund folks to share information. And so your people should be trained, you know, that they should have their antenna up about just good old-fashioned inside information from inside a company. As a general matter, in my experience, you know, and the issue here is really what are the rules of the fund of the person supplying the information? And I'm sure your people will say, well, how do I know what those rules are? And it's a good question because you don't know. But what, you know, what generally seems to be the rule of most hedge funds is if people are allowed to share their ideas, they're allowed to say, I like this stock, here's why I like this stock, here's what I think, you know, consensus is, here's why I think consensus is wrong, you know, those kinds of things are generally permissible under most hedge fund rules. And so when your people have those kinds of conversations, they can be pretty comfortable that that's okay. The areas where it starts to cross the line is if, you know, one person at one hedge fund you know, shares the specific trading plans of that fund with someone outside the fund. That can start to cross the line and be a breach of a duty, and if it's material and non-public, can be insider trading. And so, you know, those are sort of two broad guideposts to think about. A separate thing just to note for this, not the subject of this training, is there's also Schedule 13D risk, which is if your people are kind of acting in concert with someone else at another hedge fund, there's a risk that if your position gets to 3% and their position gets to 3%, the government would say you were acting in concert and therefore that's 6% and you all should have filed a 13D filing. Now, look, I think that this risk only comes up when there's real coordination among two hedge funds to take an active position in a particular stock, but it's something for your people to bear in mind. Merely sharing ideas about stocks you like does not cross this line. Coordinating buying activity and voting activity and the like with another fund can start to look like coordinated activity, in which case the ownership needs to be added up for purposes of the 5% threshold under 13D. The next practical situation that I want to bring to your attention is sell-side interactions. So your people, I'm sure, you know, if you're just sort of a classic long-short equity hedge fund, you know, spend time talking to sell-side analysts. You know, a report has just come out, and just like when they talk to, you know, the company after an earnings report comes out to try to get color on it, they sometimes talk to sell-side analysts to get color on why they just issued the report they did or why they just change their rating from a hold to a buy. And those kinds of interactions are okay so long as your folks are getting color on previously disclosed reports and previously disclosed recommendations of sell-side analysts and are not getting information about future changes. Because here, you can imagine if next week a sell-side analyst who's important to a particular issuer and is the one that everybody follows is going to change his or her rating from hold to buy, that change in and of itself might end up moving the price of the stock and be material non-public information. And if that sell-side analyst tells one of your analysts inside your hedge fund about that before that's made public, well, they're breaching a duty to their employer, the sell-side bank, and that can actually be insider trading. And so, you know, the big picture is don't get information about future, you know, disclosures and ratings and reports that sell-side analysts plan to make about the companies they cover, but do get, you know, you can get color on past reports and the like. And with that, there's actually a question here. So the question is whether or not it is sufficient to establish policies around not sharing MNPI, or do you need to have actual barriers? The answer is you have to have actual barriers. If one of your people has a piece of material non-public information and you don't want to restrict yourself in the trading of that stock, you need to make sure that that person is behind information barriers. And, you know, it's easier in bigger shops to physically separate people and to train them and to electronically separate people. Obviously harder to do it in a smaller shop where, you know, there are 15 people who work there, and sometimes impossible to do. Now, it's not impossible if one of your, you know, sort of mid or lower level persons, you know, learns a piece of information. I think you can probably intercept them and train them and document that you've trained them that they shouldn't share that information. And we can probably get comfortable with that and defend that to the SEC. But for instance, if it's a portfolio manager who makes all the decisions about, you know, the trading in that book, it's not going to be practical to do it. And so that, you know, that's my practical advice to you about that. And I'm going to move on now, because I don't want to run out of time, to expert networks, and I'll let Matt address that.
Sure. As you are no doubt aware, many funds hire experts to help them understand a particular field or industry. As a general matter, it's perfectly permissible to get smart on an area that may be unfamiliar, but you have to be aware that the government views expert networks as, you know, fertile ground for exchange of inside information improperly. So, you know, the message here is not to just rely on disclaimers with the expert network saying that you don't want inside information, and also on the flip side, not to rely on their firm's compliance or disclaimers that they're not providing inside information. You know, the use of expert networks should be something that is specifically approved by compliance at the hedge funds. And what is being sought from the experts should be limited to topics like industry trends, trying to understand complex science or technology, and understand the field, not getting information that is going to be viewed as an improper edge. And that kind of risk comes up, especially when traders are talking to somebody who was recently employed by a public company about that company. Also, particular kinds of information, specific numbers about financial sales orders, or the fact that a big order is coming. And it can come up even when you're not trading stock of the company where of the company who is receiving the order. It can come when you are trading the stock of a customer, a supplier, or even a competitor. It's important to press to understand what the source of the information the expert is giving you is, and if you can't get comfortable, that should be a red flag and something that should be discussed with compliance.
One thing I wanted to mention here, Matt mentioned, you know, this notion of, you know, trading not only the stock of the underlying issuer, but also customers, suppliers, competitors. I mean, it is not the case that if you've got, so let's say you've got inside information about Apple, and you decide, okay, I'm going to restrict myself in Apple, but I'm going to go ahead and trade Samsung on the basis of that. The SEC will take the view that that's insider trading, even though you've got Apple inside information that you're using to trade in Samsung. It doesn't matter which issuer's securities you trade. If you trade based on material non-public information in any issuer's securities on the basis of inside information, you're potentially flirting with liability. And before we move on, I see two more questions up on the screen I want to answer quickly. So there's a question, can you give an example of liability for someone who traded on the basis of knowing another hedge fund was trading? The best example I can give you is actually involves Bill Ackman. So it's a sort of a well-known story that Ackman developed a thesis that Herbalife was a pyramid scheme, and he did a whole bunch of work on that, and he shorted the stock. And then he showed up at a conference and announced it, and the price of the stock went down precipitously, and he made a good profit on that. And that wasn't insider trading. That's perfectly permissible. He didn't breach a duty. He was using his own information to trade, namely to short. And then, you know, when he announced it, that was material non-public information. Bill Ackman's announcement that I believe Herbalife is a pyramid scheme moved the price of the stock. It was not public. He wasn't telling people that until he showed up at that conference, and it was material because it moved the price of the stock. So all that's okay, but this instance that I'm referring to is the SEC brought a case against one of the people who worked for Ackman, who disclosed that information, actually a roommate of one of the people who worked for Ackman, who saw from the materials that that person brought home that this was happening, and themselves shorted the stock. And so this is an example of someone learning something about the plans of a hedge fund to do something with a particular stock, going out and trading on it, and the SEC brought a case. And so that's an example where this actually happened in the real world. Now that case happened to have kind of fallen apart for reasons unrelated to that legal theory, but the SEC has that theory and it will use it. The next question I see is, can you ask a sell-side firm if they have initiated research coverage on a company? To me, it seems like the answer is yes. I can't think of how the mere initiation of coverage would be material, but I guess I'd need to know more about the facts. So that's my thought on that. And it would also depend on whether or not that information was, you know, a closely guarded secret at that time. Okay, we'll move on to electronic communications. So
in thinking about the practical aspects of this training, you know, the key for your compliance department for the traders is to understand that in the world we live in, literally everything that is posted on the internet, in emails, IMs, chats, texts, social media, can live forever. And the everything that is written down should be written with the assumption that one day it's going to be public, and asked, the question should be asked, how am I going to feel and how is it going to look then? So, you know, we frequently in our practice see tons of this kind of information after an enforcement action is initiated. The first thing that happens is we collect all of the emails, IMs, chats, Bloomberg messages, and lawyers review them, and we frequently see all kinds of things you can imagine in there that may be very well be jokes. We often see things like, let's move to the bat phone, or something like that, get off of Bloomberg. That sort of thing may very well just be an innocent way of saying it'll be easier to talk on the phone about this. Later on, when somebody looked at that, the question is going to be asked, was that a way to avoid creating a record of the exchange of material non-public information? And another important, you know, and so really, when people are writing those things, they should be taken seriously and not just treated as a conversation by the water cooler. Another tip, as John mentioned a little earlier in the presentation, is that notes should be taken as to the reasons why trades were made. But those notes should be about who said what to whom, about why the trade was made, but not mixed in with what an insider said. So, for example, the note that is listed on the presentation here is, talk to the CFO, they are going to miss numbers. If that note may very well mean, I talked to the CFO and I concluded from perfectly permissible color that the CFO gave me that the company is going to miss numbers. But if that they are going to miss numbers is your analysis, it shouldn't be in the note next to talk to CFO, because it's going to look like the CFO provided material non-public information. Also, most your firms should have policies that prohibit discussions over media that's not monitored and saved, like WhatsApp. When communications are made over those kinds of media later on, you can be sure the government's going to view that like, just like the comment, let's go move to the bat phone, as being evidence of an attempt to hide what you were doing. And the last bullet here is another important thing to keep in mind. This electronic record shouldn't be viewed as something to, the message shouldn't be avoid making an electronic record of any kind. It should be make sure that whatever the electronic record is actually showing accurately your good faith.
So the next slide. I can get it to move, hold on a second, is just a brief mention of the sort of European UK rules. They're a little bit different than the US rules. Essentially, they do also have the concept of material non-public information, although I think materiality is kind of a little bit more tightly cabined there. The information has to be of a precise nature, relating specifically to an issue or a financial instrument that would be likely to move the price of the instrument. The U.S. law does not sort of specifically say the information has to be likely to move the price of the instrument in order for it to be material, whereas the, you know, the European law does say that. The biggest difference between the U.S. law and the European law is that the European law does not include this concept of a breach of a duty. And so if you've got material non-public information, even if it was not obtained in breach of a duty, some insider violating a rule by giving it to you, in the Europe, you still cannot trade on it, and there is a rebuttable presumption, unlike an automatic presumption in the U.S., that you used the information if you possessed it before the trade. And so, look, I mean, generally, if you're trading in the U.S., you're focused on U.S. law. The kind of the thing that determines whose law is going to apply as a general matter is where the trades actually occur. And so if you're doing a lot of trading in Europe or Hong Kong or the U.K., you know, there's sort of a separate discussion that needs to be had about sort of what the, you know, what the insider trading policies need to be. I see a question on the screen. If compliance receives an email stating, I think I was exposed to MNPI with no further details, and then discusses the situation with the employee and determines no restrictions are required, should compliance document the facts of that analysis? The answer is yes, especially if you've got an email like that. We certainly don't want the SEC coming around and doing an examination a couple of years later and memories have faded and the compliance officer has left or whatever, and there's no record of what has been done to deal with that situation. And so definitely if there's a partial written record, you should complete it. And as a general matter, and this is highly fact-specific, and you might want to engage outside counsel on some of these things, but as a general matter, I would be in favor of documenting the decisions that are made about whether to restrict or not restrict, you know, and whether, you know, and what the sort of basis of the analysis is. You're always going to have an easier time defending yourself later if you've you know, sort of written down what happened so you can remember it. And the other thing about engaging outside counsel is, you know, you're now sort of developing an advice of counsel defense if you follow that counsel's advice, and if you give them the facts that are necessary, it's going to be very hard for the SEC to say that you were reckless if you followed the advice of reputable counsel and gave them the necessary information. So the next slide that we have is kind of a wrap-up sort of do's and don'ts, which is really kind of written directed at your investment professionals. And the first is they should really come directly to you, to your compliance folks, to your legal folks, rather than going to their boss. So let's say an analyst gets a piece of what they think might be MNPI. They should not go to the portfolio manager that they report to and tell them it, because they have just tainted that portfolio manager and possibly the whole firm and might even be accused of having tried to tip them. Instead, what they should do is they should keep that information to themselves, go straight to compliance or legal, tell them. Possibly some information barriers can be erected or restriction can be put in place if necessary, but there can be no accusation that they've, you know, that they've improperly tipped or some problem where they've just tainted the whole firm, and then the whole firm has to be restricted. Look, as a general matter, you know, your people should be out there in the world making clear to people that they're investment professionals and that they trade in public equities and that they, you know, they're not interested in inside information. This way, no one can claim later that they somehow duped someone into giving them information, not knowing that they were giving it to someone who might, you know, trade on it. And this is the next point, which is never to misrepresent themselves. And then really the last point is, look, this is a very dangerous area. And if your firm is the subject of an insider trading investigation and that information is leaked to the press, that can be a firm-ending event. You can imagine that investors redeem at that point, and even if you ultimately win in terms of your, you know, litigation with the SEC or you convince the SEC to go away, the firm may have been destroyed anyway. And I can give you examples of this, of firms being destroyed even though no one was ever charged, just by virtue of the rumor of an investigation. And so you really want to be very careful here because, you know, the fact of an investigation, if it becomes public, can become a problem in and of itself, even if you've sort of successfully beaten back the investigation. And so with that, that's sort of our presentation. I want to look at the questions here and see if there are any others. So the question I see here is, if compliance officer encounters a message akin to let's talk offline in an email surveillance, should compliance follow up with employees involved to ask? The answer is yes. You know, the firm, maybe something untoward is happening. Maybe someone is violating the firm's policies on you know, the capture of, you know, of electronic communications about investing decisions. And so you should follow up. And look, if the firm takes appropriate action and it, you know, either corrects that behavior or if it needs to, it terminates that person for doing something wrong, you are saving the firm. And when the SEC comes around, you have a record to demonstrate that you responded sort of appropriately to the information, as opposed to sort of lackadaisically or recklessly by not doing anything about it. Let me see if there are any other questions we want to answer. We're about 3 minutes from our sort of closing time. There was a question about circulating materials for this presentation. I believe those are available to those who signed up. Okay, with that, I'm going to scroll down and see if there are any other questions. And if there aren't, we're going to sign off. And thanks, everybody, for joining.